to come to the last lecture. So today we're gonna do, so last time we finished the description of Darmetta, and today we're gonna do the description of galaxies and also potentially of baryons, and also how to see things in Cauchy space. And then at the end, I'll show you some results. Okay. So so we saw that Darmetta, we did Darmetta, and we saw that the equation of motion were the ones of an effective fluid-like system with an effective stress tensor. And but we don't observe directly Darmetta, even though there are some observables that measure Darmetta, which are the, for example, when we do lensing surveys, we measure the Darmetta distribution. But most of the time, we observe galaxies. So how do we describe galaxies in the effective hierarchy structure? What do we want to do? We want to do an arbitrary accurate description of the system, but at long wavelength. So the derivation is very similar to what we did already for the Darmetta. So it's a very useful way to see again the derivation, the concept that we saw for Darmetta. Because for Darmetta, what we learn is that we need to parameterize in the most important, in most general way allowed by the symmetry of the problem, the effect of short distance physics. Once we learn how to do that, we can do for anything. We can do this for anything. Okay, so in fact, imagine that what's happening in the universe. Okay, so there is some galaxies here. There's a galaxy here. And in general, it will have formed by some, you will recognize a similar picture to the one we showed last, the other day. It will have formed in some time t, typically over an Hubble time matter flew in. The typical time scale is Hubble to the minus one. And matter flew in over a certain, from a certain region. And while matter flew in, there were some long wavelength fluctuations, maybe small at early times, and maybe very large at late times around it. So this is a galaxy. That for us, the galaxy is this. So we don't need to know anything about galaxies. It can be a little a kid way of representing a star. Okay, so this is the number of stars at a given location x in time t, number of galaxies, again is a very complicated function. We do the same, very complicated function of everything that it can depend on. And the only thing that restricts what it can depend on are general relativity. So what it can depend on? As we said, it's all the cosmological parameters, omega, omega Darmetta, omega baryon, blah, blah, blah. Then it can depend on how much tidal tensor is at that location, how much baryons are at that location, how much Darmetta is at that location, what is the velocity of Darmetta at that location, the gradient of the velocity, also the electron mass, the proton mass, and the electro weak constant, and everything, every parameter of the standard model. As we saw for Darmetta, okay, where this field matter? Where all these complicated fields matter? Okay, to see if a galaxy formed here, I need to know all the fields in this region. So clearly, I should evaluate, but since Darmetta didn't, or the thing that the matter that, or baryons, the material that fell into the galaxy came only from a certain region, I need to know all the fields in this path like cone, in this path tubular. So this is the path like cone, but it's the path tube. It's a path tube of delta time of order one over Hubble, so the full time of the universe. But delta x, how much is the delta x that I care? The delta x that I care is a typical, the size of the region that contains enough material so that, if that falls in, all this material has the mass of a galaxy. So this scale is about We call it 1 over km. Remember, for that matter, it was 1 over k non-linear. Here, we can have galaxies of different mass. So they could be very massive. Or even for us, a galaxy is a star or a cluster of galaxies. It doesn't matter. Okay, it's an object. It's a complicated object. But it clearly has a different mass. And if it has a lot of mass, material must form from a very, very big region around. How much? Well, it is... the expression is such that the mass of the object is basically rho times the volume, which is 1 over km cubed. Okay, apart from factors of 2 pi. So km is given by that relationship. So this complicated function is basically an integral in dx prime for d4x prime or some complicated Green's function. The Green's function that tells us how I'm sorry, let me see. Okay, a complicated Green's function between x mu and x prime nu of another complicated source, j complicated, which contains all these variables here, evaluated around this tube. Now, as we saw for that matter, this very complicated Green's function has typically support, this statement means that this complicated Green's function is like a kernel which dies off as you move in space more than 1 over km. Okay, so this is a support in delta x of order 1 over km and delta t instead of order 1 over h. Okay, so this is a very complicated expression. But now, if you're interested only in the long wavelength correlation function of this object, the statement is very complicated means that the number, how many galaxies you form at a given location in the universe is very complicated to compute. You need to compute the hydrogen cooling, the molecular hydrogen, how it cools down. It's very complicated, but if you're interested in the number of galaxies as a function of x and t, Fourier transform at k much less than k, the k associated to the mass of the object is, if you go to Fourier space and look for the long wavelength fluctuation of this field, so let's say that this, I look only at long wavelength, means that I look only for the object that a long wavelength have a special variation. And you can see that the only objects that have special variation are these ones. And this one, a long wavelength, are small. So we can't respond in the fluctuations of this field because the fluctuations of this field and long wavelength are small. So the number of galaxies at a certain location becomes integral. So the integral of this complicated, okay, let's do one more step. D4x prime, Green's function, very complicated, which I don't know what it is, x mu prime. And then I will have here, for example, d2 of phi of x prime with some coefficient, alpha of x prime, plus another coefficient beta times, I don't know. Yeah, thank you, sorry. Very, thank you. Between x and x prime, then beta, maybe the idj of phi of x prime. Ah, by the way, sorry, forgot to say, online there are the final version of the notes, okay? We edited a little more stuff, so you can find them online. Both the notes and the slide that I will show at the end, all teched extremely nicely. Yes. Okay, so you read this term. Okay, but one realizes that the integral over the special part of x minus x prime It's very easy because these fields, I'm interested on wavelength much, much longer than the scale, than the typical variation of this field. So this field, I'll say it again. These fields vary on wavelength much, much longer than the wavelength where the Green's function has kernel, has support. So this can be, okay, let me drop this stuff. You can include it later. So this is more or less equal to the integrand dt prime and d3x prime of the Green's function, very complicated, between x and x prime. These are still mu. So I can do the following thing. I can say that this field is d phi of x. I can tell her expand around the position of the field plus a derivative. So a derivative of Laplacian of phi di times delta xi plus dot 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 dot. Okay. Now, the fact that and because delta xi is xi minus x prime I, okay? Now, the fact that this is a function, Bartesian invariance, this is a function of xi minus x prime I. In space, we have translation invariance. And this has support only on distances of order 1 over canon linear. So this means that this is a function of x, so it comes out of the integral. So this becomes dt prime. Then I can do for each of this doesn't depend on x prime anymore. This doesn't depend on x prime anymore. So this becomes integral. Then this means that here I can do the integral in x prime, and I get a number. I call it kernel 1. It's a number that is a function of t and t prime, what is left, times Laplacian of phi of x. Plus, then the other term is also independent of x prime, so becomes di, okay, by rotational invariance also the first integral will be zero, so let me just do the second one. So there will be this, and then there will be di dj of Laplacian of phi of x delta xi delta xj. Now, by rotation, this Green's function will satisfy the symmetry of the problem. It's very complicated, but it will be specially translation invariant, especially rotational invariant, because the universe is like that. So the integral delta xi times this, it must be proportional to a vector, but there is no special vector in the universe, so it's zero. And this one instead gives me delta j. So this becomes di dj di di of Laplacian of phi. And then I can do the integral delta xi delta xj times this, which by dimensional analysis, it will be a number with the units of length square. And the only length that this object knows is 1 over km. So this becomes 1 over km square that I put here. Okay. With another coefficient that depends on the object that you integrated over, tt prime. And one can go on like this. So this Taylor expansion special derivatives. You see, introduce these terms that are down by what? In Fourier space by k square over km square, which are much less than 1 if I look at k much longer than km square. But of course, if I'm looking for the correlation function on number density of galaxies, I'm going to look at wave numbers much longer than the size of a galaxy, which is the size of the region that collapses in the galaxy. So this is always the regime where we're interested really in galaxies. Okay, so this tells us that the general form of this very complicated number density of galaxies, if I look at long wavelength, will be integrand dt prime of some kernel between t and t prime of whatever is of a field evaluated, at the same location but at a different time, and here also same location but a different time. So a field allowed by general relativity evaluated at the same location at a different time, plus another kernel, the derivative now of the same field evaluated at the same location but at a different time suppressed the derivative suppressed by km square, and so on and so forth, plus potentially also another kernel, kh1tt prime, and now another field that is allowed by generativity, for example, the idj, the ivi of dark matter, evaluated xt prime, and so on and so forth. Okay, what are, so this tell, this is a, you recognize that this is very, very similar to the expansion that we found for the for the for the for the stress tensor. It's very similar. In fact, it differs only for a few details. In fact, let me finish to recover it a bit more clearly. So you have all this structure. What are the axes at which we should evaluate? To be precise, clearly, you see that this object might have moved, maybe at some long wavelength velocity, so it was coming from here. So this integral in the past, should be down a location, x, which is what the point had in the past. So this x is really x fluid, which is a function of the position you're considering, at the time you're considering, and the time prime, you want to know where the fluid was, element was at the time t prime. It's basically, as we said, x minus the integral of v between t and t prime. And the velocity depends on x minus v, so this is a bit of an iterative definition. So once plugs in, but since the velocity is also long wavelength velocity, one can respond and gets the most general form. So this is, now, as we said, okay, what are the most general terms we can write? Most general terms. As we described for dark matter, phi, the gravitational field, is not diffeomorphism invariant, so we cannot write it. First derivative of phi, also, we can set them to zero by doing going to the local inertial frames, so that's also zero. And we have two derivatives of phi, the idj phi. So that's okay. Then what about the velocity? Notice that, okay, can you put the density over density? Yes, the over density is locally observable, but the Poisson equation, the Newton equation, this is equal to this. So I can just use this for delta. So that's already included. What about the velocity of a field? Again, if you do a boost, you can do even a small velocity boost, then becomes a Galilean boost. Then the velocity goes into velocity plus a constant. So the velocity is not a scalar under diffeomorphisms, but the gradient of the velocity is. So that's okay. Then what else? We could have written time derivatives. Then there are special derivatives. We can add any special derivative that we want, all suppressed by the mass scale of the problem. They naturalize, we saw how they arise. Okay? Then what else? What about time derivatives? Well, it's easy to realize that under a time-dependent boost, this is not invariant. So one really should use the convective derivative, the time derivative along the flow. We would like to do the time derivative along the flow, which is what enters in the fluid equation, for example, but which is equal to d in dt plus vi d in the xi. But one can see that this, including this, is actually already automatically included into this expression, because if you're including the time derivative, it means that the field is sensitive to how the field is changing. The number density of galaxies will be sensitive to how dark matter changes around the point of observation. But we just declared that it's sensitive around the whole trajectory, so, okay, it's already included. Okay, and then what else? Now, there is something we forgot here, which was also in the stress tensor. Remember, maybe I should write an analogy of the stress tensor. Remember that the stress tensor we wrote, the stress tensor was a two tensor of x. So, of course, there is a trivial difference in the number of indices. The number density of galaxies is a scalar. The stress tensor is a two tensor. So when you say what it can depend, the function for the stress tensor was a function of two indices, was a tensor. So it was a function very complicated. Which depended on all the fields, for example, D2, phi long, evaluated on the path, on the pass like cone. But also, there was the fact that even when you take the expectation value over the Schur modes, remember that we derive the stress, the fatty stress tensor, we say there is a stress tensor, depends on the Schur modes. How do we express it? We take the expectation value over the Schur modes. And then the function is a function, all of the remaining function is only a function of the long mode, of the long modes. But we say, but it's possible that the stress tensor in the given universe is different than what it is on average. And we added the stochastic term to account for this term, for the difference between what the stress tensor is in a given universe and what is on average. So here we had the delta tau ij. So even here, we should add this had the property that delta tau has zero average, but it has n point functions, like delta tau square, delta tau of x prime, for example, was delta of x minus x prime, as local support of size of the canolinear cube. So here is the same. Similarly to what we saw for dark matter, here there is epsilon of x fluid. I mean, again, it should depend on the stochastic variable. So we should epsilon of x t prime and t on the pass light. So on the pass tube. The physical intuition for this epsilon is that even though given a certain fixed long wavelength configuration of the long wavelength fields, given a certain configuration, what I get in the universe every time can be slightly different because the short modes are actually slightly different in the various universe. What are the correlation functions of the short modes? Since they're short, so we have the stochastic term, epsilon of x. These are stochastic term. And it has the property that on average is zero, but it has, again, since it's made out of short modes, it has all local correlation functions on the size of the region, the pixel that corresponds to the mass contained in the galaxy. Of course, this is non-Gaussian. For example, there is also epsilon of x, epsilon x prime, epsilon x double prime. But it must be local, because it's made of short modes. So it's delta of x minus x prime. So this delta, I mean, we said that we don't put the error, but there is always an error. So delta 3 of x minus x prime, delta prime of x prime minus x double prime over k mass to the 6. OK. And these are all the terms that we need to describe the distribution of galaxies. Now, notice that similarly to what we saw for dark matter, so how do we compute correlation function or actually even the field itself of the galaxy, not just expectation values. One can even try to compute the field itself. Well, one just use this formula. So this is the number density of galaxies along wavelength. Let's just normalize it. I mean, by redefining the coefficient, we can just say that this is the number density of x over the homogeneous part of the number density of galaxies, which is the fluctuations of the number density of galaxies over number density of galaxies, because the homogeneous part is constant, so it doesn't matter for the long wavelength part. And then you can see that one computes, for example, delta number density of galaxies. So one solves this in perturbation theory. So the number density of galaxies, I have all this bunch of terms times objects which are made out of the dark matter field. And we can use the former lecture to compute perturbative the dark matter field. We saw that the dark matter field, for example, which we call delta, for example, we can write, and also theta, the velocity, we write it as a sum over delta n times functions of time to the n. And delta n, for example, delta n of k was integral in dq1, dqn, delta 3 of k minus q1, minus qn, fn, a kernel of q1, qn, delta q1, delta n qn. So this is the general expression that we get in perturbation theory, where we also include here the counter terms from the stress tensor. So this, with the dark matter theory, we can compute this correlation these fields, and also their expectation values, their correlation functions with arbitrary precision. And then we can plug this here, and solutions for the dark matter field are inherited by the galaxy field, and we can get the galaxy field in terms of the dark matter fields with some coefficients. So, for example, will be therefore integral in dt prime of, for example, kernel 1 between t and t prime times, the first term is Laplacian of phi, which is proportional to delta. So the first term is sum over n d of a prime t prime to the n delta n of k, if you look at the set of a number k. And then, as we did before, this integral can be formally done. So these are sum of some coefficient, which we can call bn of t, times delta to the nth order solution delta to the k. And therefore, one can see the power spectrum of galaxies, delta galaxies, k and k prime, is some coefficients bn, bm, schematically, t of t, times delta n, delta m, k prime. So once you know how to compute this, and that's what we did the last lecture, one knows how to compute the galaxy distribution. Now, these coefficients, as I told you, so therefore the difference with respect to the calculation that we did for dark matter is in the details. It's not the difference. The correlation functions of galaxy fields are expressed as linear combinations of correlation functions of dark matter fields. And the terms that are allowed are very similar to the one that we saw for dark matter, with little differences. And it's worth to highlight one difference that is due to the following. So for dark matter, the effect of short distance to long distance was encoded in tau j, which entered in the form that delta of dark matter was proportional to two derivatives of tau. Remember, there was a in the equation monitor for the momentum, there was the divergence of the stress tensor. And then in delta, there is another derivative. So there are two derivatives in delta. Why? Here, so for example, the stochastic contribution was coming like this. So which means that the delta stochastic was going like k to the fourth. So it was very small, k over k non-linear to the fourth, and was particularly small at long distance. It was decaying very, very fast with long distances. The fact that delta is proportional to tau, which actually, to the derivative of tau, which came from the fact that the VI, the momentum, the change of momentum was proportional to the derivative, to the divergence of the stress tensor. That's what gives these two derivatives here, is the fact that there is overall momentum conservation. The total stress tensor must be conserved. And this is why it goes like k to the fourth. Now, for galaxies, the stochastic term just enters directly. So for galaxies, delta galaxies, there will be a term proportional to this epsilon directly, which is there is not derivative, so there is epsilon. Galaxy will be simply proportional to epsilon of x, which in Fourier space means that delta galaxy stochastic, the expectation value will go like will proportional to epsilon ok prime. And the Fourier transform of this is nothing but 1 over km cube. So there is no k cube here. So if you really want to get the units right, here there was 1 over k linear cube. Here is 1 over km cube. But so the stochastic contribution from galaxies to galaxies, the effect of short distance physics and long distance, the purely stochastic one, does not decay at infinite distance as for dark matter. So the difference is a bit in the detail. Where is coming from? This k to the fourth was coming from the fact that there is a divergence of the stress tensor, which was momentum conservation. Indeed, the number density and the momentum of total matter is conserved in time. I mean, we're not creating dark matter, we're not destroying dark matter. But instead, the galaxies are being created and destroyed because now there is a galaxy, before there was not a galaxy. The galaxy formed some time. So the fact that here there is not a suppression like this is matter and momentum non-conservation of a certain population of galaxies. Galaxies are not conserved. And now, okay, so that's a nice, for example, a nice physical picture. And this picture, and like many others, for example, these coefficients that we saw in the number density of galaxies are what are called biases. And many of these features were already kind of, they're very nice arguments by famous astrophysicists like Zeldovich or Peebles, that, for example, argue that short distance physics for dark matter should have given like this term. And also people already since the time of Kaiser, from the very beginning, they already understood that dark matter should have had, galaxies would have been proportional to the dark matter field with some coefficients. And these coefficients are called bias. And in fact, the galaxies are called bias tracers of the dark matter field. What the FET theory does is simply develop a formalism where one doesn't need to be clever, doesn't need to be to know anything. You just follow your nose, do the calculation, and you get the right answer. Okay, there is no knowledge needed of the astrophysics, no thinking about what's happening in short distance physics. One does the calculation and gets the right answer. Just follow his nose, unless he does an algebra mistake. Okay, the only option is algebra mistake. So all these physical pictures that were in pieces in the last 3 decades, there is a contribution of short distance physics, there is the bias tracer, now they all fit together in a formalism that is very rigid, and so one cannot do mistake, cannot double count, cannot forget a term, unless we do an algebra mistake, okay? There is no conceptual mistake one can do. Okay, so to summarize, yes, by the way, Please ask some question, because today I feel a bit alone, okay? So please, okay? Please ask even any question, okay? Yeah, yes. In fact, the bias, exactly, the bias was already known in the literature. What is now, it's the full set. Nothing is missing, and nothing can be removed. Okay, it's just that. Okay, and there is a stochastic. Even the stochastic, people already knew that there should be a stochastic. But now it's all the most general stochastic term you can put. So this is the only novelty. Okay. Thank you. Yes, please. More questions, please. So. Oh, good. Oh, thank you. Yes. Okay, from, yeah, you. Okay, the way they enter the calculation, okay, the physical interpretation is that the field and number density of galaxies at a certain location x, a long wavelength, so long wavelength, I approximate to be the expectation value of the true, I mean, the one that they are computing the effective theory is the expectation value of the true number density of galaxies on a given long mode fixed. So the expectation value of the short modes in a given long background. But I can have, you see, there can be, in every realization of the universe, there could be different realization of the short modes. And they affect long distance physics because two short modes can give a long mode still. Maybe small, but they can give it. So I say, okay, then there is this contribution, which we call epsilon, that account for the difference between what I get on average for a given long mode and what I act in reality. However, since this is just made the difference, so this is defined between the true one minus the average. So this is made only from short modes. So the correlation function must be localized in a region of canon linear. And that's why there is this. So this, you see, if I don't specify that, this can be anything, and so I did nothing. So this is crucial, right? Okay, from a Moorfield theory point of view, this is the fact that when we integrate out, the law, this is like doing the integral of the path integral over the short modes over a given background field long. But in informalism, you need to know the wave function of the short modes. You need to correctly know the wave function of the short modes that needs to be also renormalized. And that's what this term does. It's the correction due to the wave function of the short modes, which in correlation function matters. For example, so these are a bit unfamiliar because people familiar with the S matrix never need to do this. But because in S matrix, we specify the initial state to be a certain long wavelength particle, low energy particle. So that's, if some of you is more field theory, with more filter background, this is the answer. That can help, at least. Okay, so, thank you. Oh, two questions. Let's see, let's get to five, please. Okay, at least five. So to summarize, we saw that thanks to the counter-term and the general parametrization, we have long wavelength perturbative expansions for the dark matter, and we can write delta k prime as a bunch of terms like correction, which are like delta k prime linear, and then there are corrections. The scale like 1 plus k over k non linear to the 3 plus n plus k over k non linear to the 3 plus n l. These are the loops, which is epsilon delta minus. These are the loops terms. And then there is also contribution that comes from the counter term. That, remember, that goes like k squared over k nonlinear square plus k to the fourth over k nonlinear square. Dot, dot, dot. And this comes from the stress tensor. Or, equivalently, if you look at the loop expression, the UV part of the loop, which was called epsilon S bigger, the UV part of the contribution. For galaxies, so, and this is possible only after adding counter terms, after adding counter terms and renormalization. Otherwise, we would have gotten the correction would have been 1 plus lambda over k nonlinear to the 3 plus n times the number of loops, which would be bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. So, okay, just to remember. So, all this thing of the fatty theory is not an option. We don't do because, oh, we want to be fancy. No, because otherwise it doesn't work. Okay? And then, what about galaxies? Galaxy, delta galaxy of K, delta galaxy of K, you can see that it just simply, the correlation fashion of Darmstadt with some coefficients. So it will be like, there will be, you can write again, delta Darmstadt of K prime, a three, that is a linear level. And then what do you have? You have this coefficient. So you have all the possible higher derivative biases. Remember that we had d2 phi with kernel 1 plus kernel 2 d2 over km square d2 phi plus dot, dot, dot. So they give a series which goes like 1. Maybe I should put it... So coefficient 1 plus coefficient 2 k square over km square. Ah, by the way, sorry, just to be clear, here there are always order 1 numbers, right? I'm just giving the scaling. Okay, this is not the true answer. Otherwise, I wouldn't need to compute the L loop if I knew the answer. No, there are order 1 numbers here that we need to do the calculation to get the right answer. So here, again, there is a derivative expansion in derivatives. So this is the bias derivative expansion. And you see, it fails. This perturbative expansion fails a number of order the size of the object. And the size of the object, the size of the object is very big, the theory is going to fail very early because in K. Okay? Then for each coefficient here, I can compute the Darmstadt correlation function to the order I want. And the correlation function goes like 1 plus k over k nonlinear to the 3 plus n L, where n is the fatty slope of the potential, plus k over k nonlinear to the 3 plus n times L times 2, and so on and so forth, where each term is smaller and smaller. So these are Darmstadt loops. And again, when you do the calculation, pretty much this. One gets this, similar to what we get for Darmstadt, we get this nice expansion only after renormalizing the loops, canceling with the counter terms. So similarly here, when we do these loops, there will be some divergent loops here, some divergent loops that needs to be absorbed, the physical part needs to be resolved with this coefficient here. Similarly, you see, these coefficients are the same as what we saw for the stress tensor, just that the stress tensor has a two derivative in front. So as for the Darmstadt, we need to adjust the coefficients of the stress tensor to cancel the ultraviolet divergences of the loop and give the right results. Here, there will be sometimes, this is a number that I invented, and I can use this number to reabsorb. I do not know what is the true number of this. So we can reabsorb some divergences that appear in the loops to cancel the divergences and to give the right values, and the right value needs to be fitted to observations. So this parameter ultimately, even after renormalizing, becomes renormalized once, after renormalization, And this need to be fitted to data, like the speed of sound needs to be fitted to data of their meta, the speed of sound of their meta. So very similar. Okay, last thing. Okay, so right now we are this way we have computed their meta correlation function, galaxy correlation function. Can we match? Can we compute something that we observe in experiments? Not quite yet. Not quite yet, because we don't observe most of, we could predict lensing. So with their meta already we could predict lensing, gravitational lensing, which is the typical bending of light due to the presence of galaxies and matter in the middle. Are there questions?
I have
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
What is scheme of
this is everything like in quantum field theory. That is, we can choose a normalization scheme, and the final result, unless we do an algebra mistake, will not depend on the normalization scheme. That is, physical observable do not depend on the normalization scheme, but actual some so. Difference in the difference that we get in the normal in difference result in the normalization the dependence that we get in observable due to the normalization scheme are really proportional to higher order terms that we did not compute in our calculation. Okay, so if one can, in fact, that's the way to estimate the size of the next order correction, how much our result depends on the normalization scheme. The way we do the calculation here is we did explicit example for Darmeta. We regularize the loops doing a cutoff. We normalize and then we have a CS normalized. And this, how do we do it? How do we determine the number? We simply fit, impose, for example, one way is to impose that the power spectrum of the Darmeta, of the theory agrees, and this is the true. We impose that they agree at some lower number. The theory, and so this is data and theory, and EFT, they agree at some specific K, and then that's the speed of, we determine the speed of sound. That's one way. And then one can try to be a little more optimal, but to get the better value. But, okay? One way. Of course, one way. Of course, yes, that's another property of the effective theory. That, you see, the fact that I have this expansion, so that's one way. You look at data until it works. Of course, as we said, we're doing a derivative expansion. You see, it's an expansion in K over K nonlinear, so it's going to work very good. The more you go here, the better it works, and at some point it fails. So the range of validity is when this fails. Very good. And of course we know that, suppose you do a one loop calculation, you know that the next order calculation in their meta should be like this. And we know more or less what is K nonlinear. For example, we can get an order of magnitude estimates from K nonlinear by computing the one loop and see how much is this, what is K nonlinear. But also without knowing, you know that K nonlinear is not gonna be one centimeter. Okay, it's gonna be 10 megaparsec, more or less. The distance is not gonna be 10 to the minus 3 megaparsecs, it's gonna be 1 centimeter. So it's order one here, it's order 1 megaparsec, order K nonlinear of order 1. So this one can estimate the order of magnitude already, even before the calculation. So clearly, the theory, see, and then if you plot this term, the term that I don't compute will go like this, grow a high K. So this gives an order of magnitude sense of the error bar, of the prediction. Is the term I didn't compute, for which we know that roughly the scaling and it's something that is grows steeply with K and is over the one and K nonlinear. So one can plot this and give a sense of the mistake of the calculation. So this is called theoretical error. It's the same as what people at LHC do when they have a prediction. They do, for example, the quantum chromodynamics calculation in two loop. Well, there is a mistake because they didn't do the three loop. And you can plot in this way. In our case, since the derivative expansion, the error bar becomes larger and larger as you go to higher k. And if these are the error bar, they become smaller as you go to higher weight number. There is a point where the error bars of the data are too small with respect to the theoretical error. And that's where we should stop, more or less. So in fact, one of the properties of the effective theory is that since you have a very solid theoretical framework, now you know what is your theoretical error. You know more or less how well the theory should work. And if you want a certain precision, you kind of know how many loops one needs to do, even before starting. OK. Yes. Yeah, first of all, as I said, you might decide not to know anything about the object. You look at things that look blue in your eyes and that are red in the eyes. You don't know the different masses. You try to fit this parameter, and you find that the two, so secretly, the red galaxies have more mass than the blue galaxies, but you don't know anything. And then you find that these numbers are different, I mean, for the two things are different. But if you know the mass, you can estimate Km by saying that mass times rho, this is the background energy density, of the universe, okay? So the last thing to make prediction is that sometimes we observe object not in coordinate space, but in redshift space. That is, we observe the object by their angle, but their distance to us is not determined by the by how distant they are, but by the redshift they appear to be in our eyes. So this is called redshift space. So we see objects, so this is called redshift space. Redshift. And I want to spend 5 minutes on that so that you can see that you can get the full prediction. Redshift space distortion. Okay, redshift space. So what is redshift space? Yes. So basically, in redshift space, we observe the object not in coordinate, but in redshift space coordinate. Redshift space coordinate is something very simple. It's a change of coordinate, which is equal. The ones that the telescope sees, this is the telescope, is the FRW coordinates, x, plus z hat dot the velocity over ah times z. That is, here, let me focus on a very far patch of the sky, which is kind of very distant from me. And I'm observing the galaxies here. The angle is pretty small, so I'm just talking about a small region, because it doesn't matter for the effective theory. We're talking about short distances, so we're a small region. So on these directions, I see the true coordinate for the object. But if the object moves towards me, it will look like if it is closer than what it is. And this, therefore, the z coordinate is changed by this. Now, this is not so subtle. It's subtle because the velocity in the universe is not a constant. There are velocities everywhere, there are fluctuations of the velocity. So this is a function of x and z. I mean, the full coordinates. OK, so in particular, our main observable is the overdensity, but the overdensity is the one in this coordinate, not in the true universe. So, and since actually matter is conserved, the number density in redshift space times the volume element of a certain phase space or redshift space must be equal to rho times d3x. So rho redshift is equal to dx in dx redshift, so it's the Jacobian, times rho. Okay, which in English, so in particular, if you expand in perturbation, you get the delta redshift, the fluctuation redshift in x redshift, are equal to 1 plus delta of x, so 1 plus delta of x, times the Jacobian, which is dx in dx, dxr in dx, to the minus 1, minus 1. Okay. Now, of course, we always do calculation perturbation theory. We are declaring that we are being extremely accurate, but at the cost of working always at low distances. So this is actually for us, we can tele-respond. And okay, then we tele-respond. Okay, I spare you some simple algebra that you can find in the references that I point to you to show you that the important thing to notice is that this Jacobian depends on V, so depends on the fluctuations themselves. Okay, in particular, the derivative, okay, that's it. Okay, so that's what I want to say. So, in particular, this means that delta of k, delta and redshift of k, actually is delta of k. Okay, let me Fourier transform without expanding. So, exponential of e to the minus I k dot, sorry, kz vz of x over ah minus 1 times 1 plus delta of x, which is more or less equal to delta of k plus integrand d3x e to the minus ikx. Oh, sorry, I forgot here. E to the minus ikx. I'm looking with number k. So e to the minus ikx times, and then all these terms that can be tele-expanded. And there is okay, minus ikz vz over ah plus I square kz vz kz over ah square vz square plus dot dot dot. Okay, so this is the expression that we have. This means that delta redshift of k, delta redshift of k prime, the over density we see in redshift space, are expressed in terms of correlation functions of delta or delta and V or delta and V square, if I take this term, or maybe also V square, I mean, all, so it's a linear combination of the correlation function of the fields in real space. For example, for the galaxy field correlation functions were combination of Dermeter correlation functions. So galaxy correlation functions are ultimately complicated linear combination of correlation functions of Dermeter. So if you have the theory of the Dermeter, you can predict all of them at the cost of some coefficients. Now, we saw that to predict galaxies, we had some coefficients. Do we have coefficients also when we go to redshift space? And the philosophy of effective field theory in any field is that whenever you are sensitive, your expression are sensitive to short distance physics, then in perturbation theory we're going to get the wrong result. And we need to fix the mistake. Okay, you can see that these terms are z of x. So this is v of x squared. And for example, in the correlation function here we'll have delta k, v of x squared, it with number k, for example. And this object, v of x squared, it with number k, for example, v of x squared, it with number k, is integral in d3q of v of k minus q, v of q. So it has supports all the way to q plus infinity. So these objects are sensitive to short distance physics. Indeed, they are local products of fields, and even so, local products of fields are sensitive to what locally are the fields. And so, even though one looks at them at Wien number, it's sensitive to the local product to very high Wien number. So, if you want to get if you use this expression our perturbative expansion, we're going to get a mistake when the high momenta are involved. And therefore, what we do, well, we renormalize. We declare that this V square that enters here, it's actually the renormalized one, which is what? It is Let's do it for Vi, Vj. Vi of x, Vj of x is actually the Vi, Vj, Vi of x, Vj of x bare, which means that is the one I compute in perturbation theory, the one I compute in perturbation theory, which is the EFT of LSS. Because it, as we said, it's unique. There is only one way. Even though the effective differential structure allows me to compute correlation function V long, okay? But then as soon as this V long becomes short enough, it gets a wrong answer. So the wrong the short distance contribution from the effective differential structure is wrong. So we need to correct for it, and then we put everything that is allowed by the symmetries that can affect this object, so anything that has two indices. So, for example, we can write, a constant times delta ij plus, for example, another constant times ki, kj over Laplacian. Let me just write it constant like di, dj of phi, and so on and so forth. So there are a few counter terms which are called Rashi space counter terms, or Rashi space counter terms that we need to include. So when we compute the correlation function of galaxy Rashi space, ultimately we compute correlation function of Dark matter fields. First we plug the bias expansions, then there are these terms here. Ultimately, we are down to objects which are correlation function of products of Dark matter fields. And whenever this is special like this, we need to put this, which is this minus the wrong mistake, the term that allows me to correct for the wrong contribution that I get from short distance physics. And then if you do all of this, the result should work. And this is observable. So now this is observable. This is what galaxy survey look at. And this is completes the path all the way to observation. Now in the remaining 15 minutes, I will show the results to show how this theory works when we compare with the data. Okay, so let's go through some of the results, because ultimately this is not just you might like field theory, so it looks like interesting. This is, as I said at the beginning, it's essential for us to be able to go on with exploration of fundamental physics through cosmology. So let's see if it works and how much it works. So this is what we are observing. This is, for example, is the power spectrum of galaxies observed by the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. So this is this, in Rashi space. The Sloan Digital Sky Survey observed this in Rashi space. And this is the data points. And we want to reproduce this. But we want to become better than the CMB. So we're going to have precision, which is no more log-log plots. Because the CMB is a measurement which are per mil or percent precision, OK? So the aim is to reproduce this curve with per mil or better precision. Okay, this is our target. And so this, of course, is 2005, and we are getting there. So the next surveys are going to become very powerful. In fact, even these surveys are already much more powerful than what it looks like. It's simply that without a theory, we cannot analyze this data. So right now, there are data in the CAN that are not being analyzed because we don't have the theory, okay? So the data are much better than this. Okay, so this is the prediction of the effective field theory. Let's start. First, we did dark matter. So we could compare with data of dark matter, but it's very hard to observe dark matter. Instead, it's pretty easy to simulate it. So let's see how it works with numerical simulation of dark matter. So this is the ratio, the effective theory prediction over the one measured in numerical simulation that simulates dark matter. So notice that, so B1 means that the theory agrees with simulated data, okay? So notice that now we're talking about not log-log plot, but this is a less than percent precision, so that's kind of the standard now. And this is a linear theory. So linear theory, you see that it works well at very low number, hard, even hard to measure because they're very low, and the simulation has cosmic variance. And then at k of order 0.03 or so, very, very low number, it begins to fail. These are very precision measurements of simulation, so very early, you can see already 1% at this scale. Then we did one loop. Remember that, Remember that the expansion is 1 plus k over k nonlinear to the some power plus k over k nonlinear to twice the same power. So first, when the linear theory begins to fail, when linear theory begins to fail, is because the one loop term was beginning to be important. So if you compute the one loop term, you get this curve, which agrees longer with the theory. But then at some point, the loop we didn't compute, so this term is very small at low k, but then becomes large, and then the theory fails. You see that there is an improvement from linear to one loop. And then if you go two loop, you get this. So again, it increases, and then it decays. Let me put a few comments. As you see, there is order by order improvement, exactly as expected from here, okay? Exactly as expected from here, so it works. And this gray band is the gray band is the expected next term here that we can estimate. So we get a gray band here, and the theory should more or less should fail when the error bar of this object is comparable, so it should fade from here to more or less beyond here. We begin to be sensitive to the theoretical error. And okay, this is very uncertain, but ballpark is there. So bottom line is that for dark matter, H0, we seem to predict correction factor until 0.3. And notice that instead, all former theories with this precision failed at 0.03. So this is a factor of 10 in win numbers, which means that if everything works at this order so well, it means that the number of modes that there are, if one before thought that you couldn't predict beyond here, now they can have an order of magnitude more prediction. The number of modes is 10 to the 3 more, 8,000 more, and so the error bar are square root of 8,000 better. So this is like saying, oh, you have LHC, the luminosity of LHC is 8,000 times bigger than what you thought it was. So it's a big thing, okay? It's not small, it's not a little thing, it's a big thing. So it looks to work. And of course, in the notes I put, there are many, many calculations. It's not so many, but some calculations have been done. I put in the notes a list because I will mention, I think this gives a sense of what is done, but also what one can do. And as I said, this can improve the error bars. I didn't talk about baryonic effects. Let me just say two words about baryonic effect. So baryonic effect cannot be simulated. So in the lecture we did dark matter, galaxies in redshift space. But the universe also contains baryons. And the baryons, simulations lead some guidance, but not that much, because, for example, we cannot measure, nobody can claim to predict the power spectrum of galaxies. But for sure, nobody can discuss baryonic physics with accuracy, because not only physics is complicated, but it's extremely complicated, because baryons, a long wavelength, S-star forms, they hit the baryons, and the baryons move a bit. So according to which kind of stars is turned on, a supernova, or I don't know the name of the stars, that because for us it's not important. But according to the details of what the star does, the long wavelength distribution of baryons changes. So this is very complicated to simulate, but from the effective theory point of view, they are very simple. Because if you remember, the idea of dark matter was that the basic idea of dark matter is that dark matter is very complicated. So it's very, this is the universe. Dark matter is very complicated at short distances of 10 megaparsecs, super complicated. But it doesn't travel more than 10 megaparsecs. So on wavelength longer than that, it looks like an effective fluid. Slightly more tricky because it's not local in time, but okay, but it's not that complicated. Okay, baryons move differently than dark matter because they're heated up. But if you look at the cluster, baryons are still inside the cluster. It's not that they're going everywhere in the universe. So baryons are more or less in the same shell as the, in the same region of dark matter. They also, in the universe, baryons move 10 megaparsec. They move order one differently than dark matter, but just order one, not much more. So this means that baryons are just another effective fluid with mean free path of order 10 megaparsec, with a linear scale of order 10 megaparsec. And so the equation that describes the universe with baryons is just the equation of two fluids with two stress tensors. And that's it. So this means that the leading effect of baryons, remember, the leading effect for dark matter was the speed of sound that contributed to the power spectrum as the leading effect from the stress tensor was this term C squared, K squared, P OK. P11, okay. So this that was the correction to the power spectrum, the speed of sound. And the same is for baryons. There is a different speed of sound, which is due to the star formation physics. So speed of sound, we call it C star, it's due to stars. And basically, changing the speed of sound of baryons, you should get any form of astrophysical star formation mechanism that you get. Very much like changing the dielectric constant of a dielectric material, it's always the same stuff. That's why effective theories are good and we know how to do them, because it's always the same stuff. So the dielectric material, any dielectric material, you change the dielectric constant, it's gonna work. In fact, these are, for example, compared to the effective field theory, as you change, the dots are different star formation models, supernova, gamma ray burst, wind, lots of wind, no wind. Very, very complicated stuff. They're not true simulation, they are toy models. But whatever they do, a change of C star should match the data, and you see that change of C star indeed matches the data, up to some weird number when the theory fails because we didn't do two loop. So this works, okay, this works. Next. Okay, recently, it's also very nice, recently some people noticed that you can, this group, based in Princeton, notice that the power spectrum can be written in this form so that the loop that we do actually take, you can substitute P with this basis, and then is a sum of functions which are analytic, and you can do the integral. So the calculation becomes extremely fast, practically analytical. Okay, so we saw that dark matter works. Let's see about galaxies. So this is the power spectrum of dark matter and halos Fourier transformed. So it's the correlation function in real space, the two point correlation function in real space, delta of x prime, which depends only on the relative difference. For dark matter, and this is the correlation is very large short distances and very small and long distances, but there is a peak here, which is called baryon acoustic oscillation. And you can see that it works, this is for dark matter. It works in Fourier space, so it's gonna work in real space. And here for halos, these are halos in the simulations, it works equally well, you see, for halos. So halos, which are the galaxies, how we do galaxy simulation, they're basically halos, it works. And the last thing we discussed was redshift space. And this is I'll guide you through this. This is now it's the ratio. So before I was plotting both the theory and the data. Here I'm going back to the ratio. So ratio of theory versus numerical simulation. These are what simulation people call galaxies in redshift space. Because they don't simulate the galaxy, but there's a model. But then they also put the redshift space projection. And but since now there is redshift space, you see that what counts is the velocity along z. So the power spectrum will not be rotationally invariant anymore. Depends on the angle of the line of sight with respect to the z-axis. And so the power spectrum will depend on this angle. And since the angle is 2 pi, as an angle goes over 2 pi, we can, instead of talk about the dependence on the angle, we can talk about each Legendre component with respect to the angle. We can Legendre transform and talk about each Legendre component. So the three curves are the monopole, quadrupole, and octopole of this distribution. There is no dipole. And you see that, again, the effective theory, this is one loop, so there will be some mistake. So one loop, it works well at low k, and then at some when number it fails. This is a higher ratio than ratio 0, so actually it works all the way to 0.4. So you see that it works. And the community has so far computed the first observable. We just made it, okay? That was done like a few months ago. We just computed the first path to compute the first observable to the lowest order we could. So we just took the geodesic, the quickest path to that, but it's very low level because we just did this small calculation. And this means that we could do the data analysis. And this is the Sloan data versus the effective theory. And you see, it fits the data. These are true data. Now, it's no more simulation. This is nature, okay? And what it turns out that they don't analyze the people beyond this point, but they have data beyond here. There are lots of data. And the robot, you see, they shrink very much as you go to high K because the information is all at high K. And now, one, in principle, could use the effective theory to analyze much higher weight number. Okay. Of course, there is a lot of things to do. Is a monopole and quadrupole. But for this lecture, we can just say, monopole and quadrupole. But the point is that theory goes through the data. Yeah, so let me finish by saying that, so there are many calculations. So let me just summarize. So this is a summary of what we did, actually. We are trying to compute something that allows us to match to better interpret the calculation. So in the notes, there are several directions that have been beginning to be explored. For example, dark energy, neutrinos, anything that you think can be in the universe one can compute the corrections in the nonlinear regimes, and this is the formalist to do that. And some of these are non primordial, non Gaussian, some have been done. I gave you a list. And also for each quantity, I gave you the list of what has been computed so far. So you can decide to help. Okay, so I think to summarize, many of the ideas behind the effective theory were already the fact that there should be a long wavelength expansion was already there since the time of the Zeldovich. But it took 30 years to get to this point because, for example, dark matter. You see, it's not so trivial to imagine that a long distance changes nature and it has a speed of sound, a viscosity, the emergent property. So it was a pretty long journey. But since we just got there are a million things to do. So there's a lot of things one can do. Basically, take any point function and compute it to next order or realize that there is a dark energy that it wasn't computed, include it. And I think, to tell you the truth, only young people are working on this field. So the old people are leaving a lot of room for the young. So if this theory is right, and I think it's right, but I might be wrong, then they are leaving lots of good opportunities for you. In a sense, it's like when QCD was discovered, then, okay, somebody discovered QCD, but there were lots of calculations you could do. Like gluon-gluon production of X from gluon-gluon fusion. And who did the calculation, who did it with QCD, is the right answer. And that answer stays forever. It's the right answer on nature. That's it. So doing calculation with the right theory is nice because then it's the answer forever. So if this is right, and I think it is, but you can doubt, but if this is right, if you do the right calculation, then it's the right calculation forever. So it's a nice opportunity. So I think this tells you that it's pretty an open field, and I just say that there is a lot of place to contribute, and the community is pretty small. So I think this is an opportunity for young people to come in, and in particular, it's an ideal situation, because right now, contrary to, for example, in particle physics, where you have to wait many years for data, here, the data are already there, And we don't analyze them because nobody did the calculation. So it's an ideal place for a theoretical physicist. Okay, so since I'm the last speaker, I'll just conclude by saying that we should thank the organizers. So this is Paolo. Thank you very much. This is Ravi, and this is Merdad. Oops, sorry, no, sorry. This is Merdad. I would like to have such a picture, okay? So this is Merdad, okay? This is the one I found online. Okay, thanks very much for organizing this. I think we should thank the organizers because they let us stay 2 weeks in this beautiful place with lots of people. So thanks them and also thank ICTP. Okay, thanks.